This morning, and I loved it. Thank you all very, very much. Great. I welcome you here this morning to the worship of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and I welcome you that we can do this freely at Wake Forest Baptist Church. It is our privilege, isn't it, this morning to be together, to praise Him, and to hear music that our feet are on the rock. If you're a guest with us this morning, we want you to know that at the end of the service, we have a welcome center for you, and you may go over and get information that you want about the church. It'll be to your right. There'll be someone there to welcome you. Most of all, we just want you to know how very glad and honored we are to have you worshiping with us this morning. Now, let's continue to worship.
Give him glory and praise. give to God the glory and praise that he is due, all hail the power of Jesus' name. I invite you to stand and join together in our responsive reading, number 338, and then we will sing that glorious hymn, number 339. Let us continue in worship as we read responsively. Then I looked, and I heard the voice of many angels surrounding the throne, and the living creatures and the elders. They numbered myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands, singing with full voice.
Worthy is the Lamb that was slaughtered to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing.
Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them singing.
To the one seated on the throne and to the Lamb, blessing.
And the four living creatures said, Amen, and the elders fell down and worshipped.
Therefore God also highly exalted him, and gave him the name that is above every name.
So that the name of Jesus every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
To talk with y'all about, remember this? Y'all know what this is? What is it? Worship cart. Before we get to that and explaining it to everybody else, we're going to review just a little bit about All Kids Sunday School in August when we talked about worship and we were learning the elements of worship and then what the worship cart is. We started in August with Only God is Worthy of My Worship. From 1 Chronicles, our verse was, For great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. He is to be feared above all gods, for all gods of nations are idols. But the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and joy are in his dwelling place. And we learned that we worship the one true God. There is only one God, and we worship him. Then it's been a while. I'm going to ask you to sift through all that you've learned since August. The first one was, I worship God when I sing. Okay? We talked about all the things that we do in worship that have to do with singing. Does anybody remember what it is we call the songs that we sing? Yes. Hymns. That's right. We sing hymns, and we typically have three in worship. And then we talked about, I worship God when I pray. Do you remember who leads us in prayer on Sunday mornings? Who do you see lead us in prayer? Anybody but Noah? Quinn? Dr. Slater is one of them. And then deacons take turns with the offertory prayer, and they lead us in prayer. They're some of our leaders as well. The last thing we learned was, I worship God when I give to him. So we have many things we give to God. Do you remember some of the things we talked about? What are things we give to God? Noah? Offering. There are other things we give to God too. Anybody? We give our time to God. We have a lot of people. Yes? Love. We give our love to God. We give our service. We share his love with others. And we have a lot of people that give their time for us for children's ministries, like yesterday with the Fall Festival. Lots of people gave their time to be here in the morning. And every Sunday morning we have people who are helping at both hours, at 9:30 and 11 o'clock with our preschoolers and children. So we learned all of those things about worship. And our bulletin, what does our bulletin tell us? Noah? What we have to do and when people are coming out. This is our guide. We talked about our bulletin being our guide. Do you remember the part about this? Grown-ups, hang on, I will explain it. But remember we talked about worship being like a soccer game? Is that starting to come back? And our bulletin tells us the plan for the day, right? And we talked about with soccer, the people on the on the field, the people on the field are the players, right? And they are watching for their turn to kick the ball, help their team. In worship, who are the players? Us, yes, all of us, everybody sitting in the pews, we're all are the participants, we are the players, and we are waiting for our turn to participate, or like soccer players, kick the ball, and this tells us what we're doing, what the next thing is. Our bulletin tells us the game plan. We are all waiting and watching so that we can participate when it's our turn to participate, right? Like you all were standing and singing. I saw most of you standing and singing when it's time to sing. And then when we pray, we're bowing our heads and we're listening to our prayers. So who are our coaches in worship? Do you remember who the coaches are? Patrick?
Mr. Bryant.
Mr. Bryant is one of our coaches. Noah? Dr. Slater is one of our coaches. I'm one of the coaches. Eliana? Your mom. So our ministers, our worship leaders, the worship team that sang up here, they were coaches this morning, helping us know what to do next. Next week, our second and fifth graders are singing in worship. Did you all know that? Reminder, you're singing in worship. So you all are going to be our worship leaders. So at different times during the month, during the year, we all help coach and worship, help our participants, everybody here know what to do when we worship. So that brings us to the worship cart. I had a couple folks looking for it this morning. Kat, I'm going to ask you to scoot over that way so I can stand here because we're going to need to turn this. So this is our worship cart. Our worship cart has tools on it that help us focus and guide us in worship. One of the first things we talked about is our worship bag. How many of you have been using a worship bag? Yeah, some of you. And in the worship bag, what's your favorite thing in there? Avery? The whiteboard? Quinn? The Bible verse slip cards? Right here, yes. Right there. Okay. Anything else? We also have pipe cleaners in there. Patrick?
The paper and the pencil.
You can add a notepad and there's a pencil in here. So these are tools to help you in worship as you're listening. You can draw pictures of what you're hearing. You can draw pictures of things that it reminds you of. And there's an eraser in there so you can erase your board as well when you're done with it. The pipe cleaner is in there. We've done pipe cleaner prayers. Remember, you can wrap it around your finger, and that reminds you of something to pray for. You can shape it into the letter of a name, like I pray for my girl, so I might make an R or an M. And so that is a prayer tool. So those are our basic bags. And here you return your bags there once you finish. You can put them on that shelf or the other shelf. Here we have take-home pages that you can take. We have younger ones on top, older ones on the bottom. These are extra ones that we haven't used during our Sunday school hour. So if you want to learn more or you want to take these home and use them, you are welcome to do that. On this side right here, we have different things that you can take that help you in worship. We have the prayer sheet where you can draw on each one, God, I prayed for, and you can we talked about that as far as different groups you pray for. We've added clipboards. The other thing we added today that I want to show you are these sermon notes. You can take one. We have this one is for younger children. This one is for older children. It's a little more detailed. On this one, you can mark off how many times you hear Dr. Slater or Mr. Bryan or me or our other worship leaders say these different things, God, save your prayer. You can draw a picture of what you're hearing as you're listening to the service, and you can write down your favorite song. So there's two sides to that, so you can get one of those. And this one is a little more detailed for older kids. You can write down more notes, the topic, questions from the sermon. This is a test. I didn't warn you, Dr. Slater, if you listen to the sermon and you're thinking and it brings up a question, you can write your question down here to help you remember. And then you can ask Dr. Slater your question on Wednesday or the next time you see him. So those are worship tools to help us focus on God and what we are learning in worship as we participate. Up, two other things up here, says worship card. What's this say right here? Olivia? Word of the day, right? Who knows what the word of the day is? Noah? Temptation. In our sermon this morning, Dr. Slater is going to be talking about temptation. You can count the number of times that you hear that word. You can write down a question you have about temptation or things that you learned about it. Up on top, also, we have our children's bulletins that you can take one, and they're about the theme of the day. They're not specifically related necessarily to our scripture, but to what our theme is. So this is out in the vestibule, out in the foyer by the elevator, so each Sunday you can come and get a worship help if you want to use it. But today, it is here. Trying not to get the wires. So we're going to have a prayer, and then as you go back to sit with your parents, if you want a bag, you can take one, okay? Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for this day. Thank you for worship. Help me to hear and listen to what your word is for today. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love So thankful for the way the music has taken to us a higher place today. Gateways on the journey to God. It's a surprising beginning, Jesus' journey we see, fresh off of his baptism. We come to our scripture text today, the temptations he's faced from the very beginning. So if you have your Bible, I invite you to turn to Matthew 4. This is right on the heels of Jesus' baptism. Beginning in the first verse, he says that Jesus was led by the Spirit into the desert to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry, one of the great understatements in all the Bible. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, man does not live by bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and they will fill you up, and they will lift you up in their hands, so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "It is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. "All this I give you," he said, "if you will bow down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Then the devil left him, and angels came and attended him. It's Sunday morning. Here we are again, the company of the committed. People who, by and large, have made a commitment somewhere along the way to be followers of Jesus Christ. But if you're like me at all, some days you wonder if you're making any progress at all. Yet we come to church, we sing victory in Jesus, we talk about being more than conquerors through him that loved us. But for so many that I listen to, there's that sense that for every two steps forward, there's at least one step back. Times like this, I think of those who are rolling over in bed this morning, a lot of our church members. They're at home drinking a fresh cup of coffee, reading the Sunday morning paper. But they have the same issues that we have. They are going out into the world knowing that there's probably more to life than what they are experiencing. They know that there's a spiritual world beyond this material world that we seem so trapped in. They know that there is a God. But for so many of us, and them and all together, where do we make that journey, take that first step? For so many, it seems like the gateway is locked. We don't know where the door is. How do we get through even the entrance point? Each Sunday, beginning today and the next 3 weeks, I want to talk about what I call gateways on the journey to God, for us and for them. And we start by following Jesus. It may sound like a cliche, but sometimes we forget that Jesus was on a journey as well. Those disciples, they learned very quickly that if they were going to follow Jesus, they better have their bags packed. Jesus never sat still. He was always moving forward. We know that he literally left Galilee and went through Samaria and then Judea. And finally, all this by foot to his way to Jerusalem, where with his disciples in tow, he hung there on a cross for you and for me. And they quickly learned that what it meant to be a follower of Jesus Christ meant to follow the same journey that Christ followed. It was true then, it's still true today. Always the invitation, follow me. Which to me says, don't tell me what you believe. We all believe the right things in this room this morning. Tell me where your feet are taking you. And when we see what stood at the beginning of Jesus' journey, then we see what stands at the beginning of our journey as well. The very first gate we must walk through, and what a surprising one it is, it begins with temptation of all things. Temptation. Please, this morning, we're not talking about an extra piece of pie for dessert, or buying that dress you didn't need at the mall, or taking a sneak at pornography on the computer. What is temptation for the Christian? For me, it is coming to grips with that which is good, but it's not the best thing. What we're going to find as we look at these temptation stories is that Jesus really never tempts us with bad things. We can usually see those things for what they are. Jesus comes, the devil, the tempter comes along and tempts us with things that are good. They just aren't good enough. And so we have these good and worthy things, and so hard to distinguish sometimes. I don't know about you, but how much easier and wonderful it would be if I could just renounce Satan and cast out demons and just kind of cozy right on into the good life that Jesus offers. But you see, we're not blocked to the road on the road to the kingdom by evil. We're blocked by things that look so good and are so sneaky. And what they are doing is that they're keeping us stuck right where we so often are without ever making that step into the fullness that we hear about and think is probably should be ours, but never quite seems to happen. So that's where temptation begins. It begins by living with something good, if you will. Daily bread, but not daily bread only. And by the way, let me give you a warning right here. If you're hearing this text and all you're thinking about is actual bread, you miss the whole point altogether. You see, in the first century, bread was the essential commodity of life. It's what they had to have to exist. It's what they often had to even use as currency to buy other things so that they could exist. But that's not where we are in 2019. Most of us, we don't need a bread truck to come up to our front porch. We are keep hoping for a Brinks truck to show up. And so that's why, even though I've never entered, there's still that secret fantasy we always have. If Publisher Clearinghouse would just knock on my front door, or some of you, even despite all odds, even as you shake your head, even as you know better, you still buy one more time that lottery ticket. Because now your fantasy is of getting that riches that is so tempting and so wonderful and the key to the next step of life. I want to show you something this morning. So this is my visual aid. This right here, in all honesty, this is what came, this is the junk mail we got just this week. I'm serious. It's heavy. It's a mess. And I thought about it. I looked through all those things. If I applied to enough credit cards, I would get enough cash back that I could take one of these great trips. Because Kathy and I took one great trip, the companies think we can just automatically pay for any more trips, which I can do by applying for more credit cards. And if I don't know what to wear, then I have Coldwater Creek. Kathy does. Won't do much for me. Soft surroundings. Anybody ever heard of that? So there's always this fantasy that we all have. If only, and fill in the blank. I remember when I was younger, if only I could pay for the girls' braces. If only I could pay for their college. If only I could pay for the wedding. And now, if only I could pay for long-term care insurance. And if only I could pay for the nursing home that's one day going to come my way. You see, no matter where we are in life, we always have these if-onlys, fill in the blank. And that's a little bit of where the tempter just comes our way. Matthew says the tempter came to Jesus when Jesus was famished. My guess is not many of you have been famished very often lately. So what might be a modern-day translation for you and me of famished? It might be in over my head, drowning in debt, stressed out, feeling a sense of brokenness, if you will. You see, this story, if we really start listening to this story, it in fact does become our story. Jesus went out into the wilderness. It wasn't his idea. The text makes very clear the Spirit led him into the wilderness. I like some translations said the Spirit drove him into the wilderness. It wasn't his idea. It was God's idea. And there's the very first great law of the journey. You're not in charge of the journey. God is. And one of the conditions that God sets for all of us in the journeys of our life is that if you live any time in this world, you are, in fact, going to be exposed to the evil one. You are going to be tempted by things. So if you want to get to the gateway to God and to the fullness of God's kingdom, then you're going to have to discover that it's going to happen at the place the trials and temptations will be where you are most vulnerable. And so you either decide to walk through it and get to the next place, or you turn your back on it and say, no more. It's always that classic decision. We say to God, thy way or my way. And there are folks who come to church every Sunday morning, maybe some of you, who want just a casual little stroll through the garden with Jesus. They want to have a little walk with Jesus, have a little talk with Jesus, a little walk with the Lord. But Jesus says the way to the kingdom is through the narrow gate. You can't walk around it. You can't tunnel through it. You can't climb over it. You've got to walk the kingdom walk, which means you've got to walk the path that Jesus sets out for us. And the next thing to notice when temptation comes, it seldom comes when you are ready for it. Jesus had not eaten for 40 days. Obviously, his hunger must have been unimaginable. And that's where his vulnerability was. The tempter, of course, knew where he was vulnerable. The tempter knows where every one of you are vulnerable this morning. He knows what is your deepest cravings. He knows what it is you're really longing for and keep thinking is the key to life. The devil knew that, and he knows that for us. And so Jesus, right then and there, he had to decide what would ultimately satisfy his hunger. You see, if you hear this story as your story, you're pretty quickly going to realize this is not easy. Because to get in touch with where you're vulnerable, to get in touch with where the temptations come, you have to go right up against all this society's message that just reinforces the cravings in your life. Yeah, I get 20 minutes with you on Sunday morning. You get dozens of letters, it seems like every day, pulling at you. You get TV, you get movies, you get all the social media, all these messages that here's the way to life, if you will. Robert Morgan says, most people want to be delivered from temptation. They just still like to keep in touch. And so we consume and we consume and we buy and we buy and we crave and we crave. And we learn the hard way, if we ever really learn it all, that these things, they just seem to keep on not having the power to satisfy but so long. So today, just like in Jesus' day, the tempter comes and tempts us with stuff. So what is the answer? Well, look at how Jesus faced it. It's about as simple as a 3rd grader can figure it out. He quoted scripture that he meditated on day and night. Man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. And there's your answer to come one of the central truths about every single one of us. And that is, in our DNA, the way we were created, God always created in every one of us a vacuum that only God can fill. There's this emptiness, and the tempter knows that and keeps trying to say, there, that universal emptiness that every one of us has because we're born with it, the way to satisfy it is just more and more stuff and stuff. Remember that day you thought, if only I had, and you got it. How wonderful it felt. Well, it was a car, or a new set of golf clubs, or I don't know what, I'm afraid to say. Whatever it was for you. And then remember how it wasn't any time at all before it kind of seemed to lose its beauty, lose its power, and you needed to go on to something else. But remember how it just made you feel emotionally full. It just kind of built up your self-esteem and your wonderful sense of wonder. But it just doesn't last much at all. I would invite you, if you have that memory, to hold on to it, to cherish it, to treasure it. Because that's the path to God. That's the reminder that what the tempter says is, in fact, a lie. You brought home that thing from the store. It seemed so great. You didn't know that it was the lead item in your garage sale 3 years from now. You know, when Kathy and I downsized from our house to a townhome on a certain afternoon, Mark Wyatt with his refugee ministry, never forget, he took out 5 pickup loads of stuff. Things that I'm sure all of those things at one time we thought were important, things we thought we needed. It was so freeing to get rid of that stuff because those things are heavy in more ways than one. The evil one wants to believe that what we have can make us happy. How many of you have more now than you had 10 years ago? Probably most of you. Do you really feel any happier today because you have those things? Jesus says if we're going to enter the gateway to the kingdom, we must forsake other things. And that word forsake is an important word. It doesn't mean we hate the world or reject the world or we go sign up for a convent or a monastery, if you will. Forsake, it doesn't mean that we turn away from material things. Jesus said, your heavenly Father knows you need those things. But it means that we recognize that all the stuff in the world has only so much power to ultimately satisfy. It's never enough. It's just never enough. Our craving, our buying, our consuming, it's like a person dying of thirst who is craving for more salt. The first step for traveling on the journey to God is for us to decide to give ourselves to not to things, and not to allow our hunger and thirst for God to be blunted by hungering or thirsting for anything else. It is to decide that we will not let our personalities or our children's personalities be saturated with envy for what other people may have or own or do. It's the decision not to announce our importance to the world by what we have or what we own. And finally, it's a commitment not to become so full of stuff ourselves that we become callous to people around us who have less. Turn those stones into bread, the tempter says. The trouble with that is it's substitute food. It doesn't satisfy. It doesn't fill. It just fills you up for a little while, and then you turn around right and be empty all over again in no time at all. These good things that so claim our attention that we end up being so full that we have no room left in ourselves for seeking first the kingdom of God. Beginning the journey, it's just the way it is. We travel faster if we travel lighter. Stuff. It just gets heavy. It weighs you down. It makes you tired, if you will. But if you hunger and thirst for righteousness, Jesus has a wonderful word for you. He says, you will be filled. Imagine that. I'm full. To be able to finally say, I am enough. I have enough. God is enough. That you will be filled. And that's why this journey is called a journey to life. Our hymn of invitation this morning, hymn number 486, learned in the first service, this is a different tune than what we're used to for this hymn. So hang in there and sing it accordingly. But maybe there are some who want to give your life to Christ or unite with this church for another church family or some renewed commitment. I'll be at the front to receive you. Let us stand and sing to the glory of God, hymn number 486. Seated for just a moment. First, let me say a word of welcome to guests that are with us. We celebrate truly that you have added to our company. We have a welcome center over to the side. Paula Goodson from our outreach team would love you to stop by. You can share any information about our church with you. I just want you to sit for a second and have more announcements than normal. If you don't think anything goes on around this church, listen to what's going on this week. Tonight, I very much hope you'll come out for Night of Hope. Beautiful witness about the work in Uganda. Annette Byrd and Dorothy Bowman sharing their testimony and sharing crafts, and just a great story for all of us to come out and benefit from. Wednesday night is our missions night that we have once a year. We have leadership from Vigilant Hope in Wilmington, which we have such a strong relationship and been there a number of times this past year. Tuesday is Interfaith Food Shuttle, wonderful opportunity to be the hands and feet of Christ for those that come out at 3:30 with an apron and cap. And next Sunday is going to be really special. If you want to invite somebody to worship, Mary McDonald, nationally known composer, is going to be with us for Composer Weekend. She'll be doing a concert that afternoon. Hope you'll be here for that. Last but not least, in all your bulletins is a form for selecting deacon elections. Several people have said to me, and I've said this, it's probably the best list, and we've always had good ones, but the best list top to bottom that we've ever had. It's a tough choice. But fill it out and just leave it on the pew. We will collect those right afterwards. Really important that you do that. So we're here. Go out. Watch out for the good. Live your life for the best. Let us bow for the prayer response to follow. Christ before you, Christ behind you, Christ within you. Grace upon grace, mercy upon mercy, love, all love. Jesus Christ our Lord, thanks be to God. Amen.